cases aren't alone going to change the world, and it's why I am so privileged to be able to introduce Lieutenant Colonel Linda Campbell. And in doing so, really, to introduce the love of her life, Nancy Linchild, as well. You know, it's customary to go through the list on the resume and the accomplishments that a person has when you introduce them. And you should know that Linda Campbell graduated from Marshall High School and from the University of Oregon in 1968. She signed up for a stint in the Air Force, and then after that, the Oregon Air National Guard, and after that, the Air Force Reserves, a stellar military career for the Lieutenant Colonel. She's a college graduate. She is an airman. She's an athlete. She's an officer. She's a civil rights champion. You can put any label on her you want because she has done so much. But I have to tell you something. An extraordinary resume is one thing, but extraordinary character is a very special thing. For her and for Nancy both. It's all about integrity. It's all about great humility. It's about the kind of inner strength that you really only see from somebody who really knows who they are and what it is that they are called to do. Those are the reasons that I am so deeply impressed by Lieutenant Colonel Linda Campbell. Now, in a minute, first when I'm done, we're going to see the slideshow, and then Linda Campbell will come up and speak. But I want you to know that I say these things not only to introduce you to Linda Campbell, but to introduce you to the very special person that Nancy Linchild was. And so after the slideshow, you will hear from Lieutenant Colonel Linda Campbell.
thank you all so much, friends and strangers and all of us family members. I can't tell you how special it is for me to have Brad Avakian here introducing me. I think the world of him, and he's done so very much for our community. And thank you to Vaughn and everyone who put this expo together. I appreciate the opportunity, and I'm very excited to be talking with you. A friend of mine recently asked me after the news of Nancy's burial, she said, "Linda, how does it feel to be so powerful?" Well, I didn't know I was powerful. At least I never thought of myself that way. Many of you here today have been at the forefront of change for our society and our generation. Many of you have picketed, you've marched, you've got laws passed, you've represented us so well. I haven't. I've been on the other side of the closet door for 67 years. I can tell you that my heart still beats fast every time I have to choose which pronoun to use, me or we. And of course, if I use we, there's always that inevitable question, who is the we of me? And then you have to decide if you're going to explain that, or if you should, or if you could. Believe me, my heart's beating fast right now just standing before all of you. Oh, I've spoken before as an Air Force recruiter and as a housing policy expert, but I never felt powerful, and I never saw myself that way, and I've never, ever shared as much of my personal story as I plan to share with you today. I say it's my story, but it's not really my story. It's the story of Nancy and me. It's the story of people like Commissioner Brad Avakian making history, standing by our side. And I hope that ultimately you'll see that it's a story of you too, of all of us, as we learn that we're more powerful than we ever imagined we could be. I grew up in a quiet family. It was back in the days of Father Knows Best and Leave It to Beaver. And of course, my personal favorite, Beaver's mom, June Cleaver. Back then, there were certain expectations of young women, girls, and I remember just about every conversation with my grandmother when I was 18 or 20 years old would always begin with, "So, have you found a nice young man to marry yet?" Well, that reflected the general attitude back then. And for me, I think it was my attitude too. When I was a youngster, I was really a pretty good kid. I met most expectations, but then, when I was 16, something changed. A girl kissed me. And I realized over time, a short time, that I was a pretty good little athlete back then too, and I played some serious softball. And some of my teammates seemed to find themselves in that same transitional space that I was in. And then we came to realize that some of our coaches were gay too. Of course, we could not discuss our concerns with them. We couldn't ask for advice. We couldn't ask questions, and they certainly could not talk with us. My God, after all, they could lose their jobs. But we were lucky. We had them for role models. We saw the dignity and worth in the lives those women lived. They showed us that there was a future for us too. And they gave us our only hope. Well, at that time, even with those powerful role models, I still could not envision a future for me being gay. So when I graduated from college in 1968, I joined the Air Force and went off to officer training school. I joined for several reasons, but certainly among those reasons was that I wanted to give myself the opportunity to find out if I could be straight and to be the daughter that my parents always wanted me to be. I thought with 600 men in the class and only 60 women. Surely there would be one man for me. Well, you'd probably like to hear some of my Air Force stories, so I'll tell you quickly. When I first got down to officer training school, and it was late into the evening by the time I'd arrived, my very first order was, "Cadet, go down to the cadet bar. The upperclassmen would like to have some women to dance with and drink beer with." Oh, I said, "I really want to, I'm tired." "Cadet, that was an order." "Okay, so." The next morning, my first class was put on by Avon. They wanted to make sure that we properly knew how to put makeup on. And my first lesson was to learn the officer's oath, which is, "I will not lie, cheat, or steal, or tolerate among us those who do." I already knew I was pretty close to the edge on that one. I knew I could get kicked out for being who I was, but that was not going to happen to me. I was going to make it through, and people were not going to find out. I did make it through officer training school. I was commissioned as a second lieutenant. And then the Air Force sent me off to another training school for 8 weeks in Biloxi, Mississippi. After I graduated from that class, my classmates and I got together at a club on base to celebrate our graduation and say goodbye before we went back to our own home bases. Well, I was sitting there, and there was a lot of beer flowing, and the fellow that was sitting across from me was a senior master sergeant, so he was considerably older than I was. And I was having a good time, but he looked pretty grim. And he leaned across the table and he said, "Lieutenant, you're not as gay and happy as you appear to be." Now, this was 1968, and I knew that that word was a very secret word, and that there was no way that this older master sergeant would possibly know what that word meant. So I said, "Sergeant, I am gay. I am happy. You should be too. Drink up." Well, we had that same conversation several times over the course of the evening. At 5 o'clock in the morning, we found ourselves leaning against the wall in the breakfast line. And the sergeant says to me, "Lieutenant, I don't think you're as gay and happy as you appear to be." Well, I no longer appeared to be gay or happy. I was really tired. and not feeling the best. And I said, please, Sergeant, don't say that anymore. And he said, oh, is that the problem? And I said, yes. And he said, I thought so. He said, after breakfast, we should probably each go back and take a quick nap, and then I think we should get together and talk. And we did that. And he told me that his job in the Air Force was to root out homosexuals and have them dishonorably discharged from the military. He'd done that as long as he could tolerate it, as long as he could stand it. And when he couldn't stand it anymore, he changed career fields. So he wanted to tell me what I could and could not do safely in the military.
Wow.
And I thought I was being so careful. So he told me these four things. He said, Linda, if you have any incriminating evidence with you at home, in storage, wherever it is, get rid of it. Do not throw it away. Do not flush it down the toilet. We can get it. Burn it. He said, you can write to your friends. Your friends should not write to you. We can open your mail. He said, your friends cannot call you. You can call them, but not from your own phone, and not from any phone on base. Use a payphone, and never the same one. You can go home and visit your friends. We probably won't follow you there. But your friends should not come to visit you. That would send up a red flag. Well, you know, if I'd been in the closet before that, that conversation drove me deeper into the closet's depth. I rarely saw any other female officers while I was on active duty. I think in the 4 years I was on active duty, I briefly met two separate women who I thought were gay. It was an incredibly lonely time for me, and I was completely alone with my secret. Well, I started to realize that my plan for the Air Force to help make me straight was not working out so well. So I decided that I should have a chat with my parents and let them get to know me better. I didn't know how to have that conversation. I'd never read anything on the subject. I hadn't talked to anybody about it. I just went over there one day and I told them. It didn't go very well. My dad said he no longer had a daughter. My mom said she wished I hadn't told them. I stormed out. A few days later, I wrote them a letter. I said I was sorry that I let them down. I said I had tried to be straight out, tried to be the daughter they wanted me to be, but I just couldn't do it. I did tell them that I was the same person now as I was before I had told them, only now I was more honest and more real. A few days after they got the letter, my dad called. He said, I didn't want you to worry. We still love you. We never again spoke of me being gay. But they did continue to love me. And they came to love Nancy too, and she loved them. After Mom died in 2004, Dad moved from Portland immediately down to Eugene to be closer to Nancy and me. And the three of us were a real family. We were the Three Musketeers. We were the Mod Squad. After I left active duty, I joined the Oregon Air National Guard, and I gained the acceptance of another very important man in my life, General Fred Rosenbaum. General Rosenbaum made my Air Force career, my National Guard career possible. He was my mentor and my friend. He used to invite me to all these parties at his house with all the other Air Force officers. And he said, Linda, you should invite your partner too. And I said, sir, I can't do that. And he said, well, if you don't, I will. And by golly, he did. Once an acquaintance of mine who was angry with me at the time had his own friend who was also a general. And he called that general up and he invited him to lunch. And over lunch, this fellow said to this Army National Guard general, I want you to know that Major Campbell is a lesbian. And remember, this is before Don't Ask, Don't Tell. And the other general, without skipping a beat, said, I'm sorry, I didn't hear what you said. And don't bother to repeat it. Now, I can't say for sure, but I think that the reason that this general didn't pursue the subject was because he didn't want to go up against my general, Fred Rosenbaum. In my 30s, and this was in the 80s, my partner and I achieved a level of normalcy that I never imagined I would have. That came with the birth of our son, Brady. I love Brady. I love, love, love being Brady's parent. And with Brady, we somehow magically became normal members of the community. We used to go to his ball games, we'd go to his PTA meetings, his student or his teacher parent conferences. I even volunteered in his classroom. And we always had holiday meals with both sets of parents. Both sets of grandparents. I remember one occasion when Brady was in daycare. I went to pick him up and we're walking down the hall to leave the building. We're holding hands and I overhear the conversation of the little girl, his classmate, with her mom. And I hear the little girl say, Mommy, why does Brady get to have two moms and I only have one? And her mom said, well, honey, you have two moms. You have me, and you have the mommy that your dad lives with now. That little girl knew that her mom just didn't get it. Managed the difficult task of coming out to my parents. I'd achieved some level of integration into the community. But it wasn't until Nancy that I began to sense the freedom of fully accepting myself. Nancy had worked long ago to accept the person that she was. And she was very comfortable with who she was and accepted herself. Nancy liked birding, and she taught me. We loved biking, we loved hiking, we even liked shopping at Costco together. Every day with Nancy was joyful. The way she and I connected proved to me that there's something more powerful going on when we let ourselves connect fully and authentically. One time before Nancy and I lived together, she lived in Eugene and I lived in Portland, and I was on a one-month assignment to Washington, D.C. And one long weekend, she came to Washington to visit me, and I had to go to work that Friday, so I had to leave her in my hotel room. I couldn't get off early, so I was at work, and as the anticipation soared in me that I could leave, finally the clock ticked down. It was 4:30, and I raced out the door, and I raced down to the subway station. And I got on the train. My stop was stop number 3. But as I got on the train, suddenly I'm thinking, maybe I should get off at stop 2. Maybe stop 2 is actually closer. No, it couldn't be. Otherwise, I would always get on and off at stop 2. Stop 3. No, wait. Maybe while the train is sitting at stop 2, I could be running off and still get there. No. Because maybe Nancy will come and pick me up and meet my train, and she'll be at stop 3. If I get off at stop 2, okay, that's definitely it. I'm getting off at stop 3. And then the conductor said, stop 2. And my body got up and walked off that train. And my mind is screaming at me, what are you doing? Get back on that train. You already decided. But my legs were propelling me forward. I'm still chastising myself. And I look up, and there on the other side of the turnstile, there's Nancy, waving and smiling. I said, what are you doing here? She said, I came to meet you. I said, I don't get off here. She said, but you did. I'm still amazed. I don't know how she pulled me off that train. Nancy and I knew, even with her metastatic breast cancer, that we were connected for eternity, that we'd be together forever, just like it says on the headstone on Mom and Dad's grave. Toward the end of her 12-year struggle, we began to dream about being able to be buried together at Willamette National Cemetery, like my parents were, and like so many other veterans and their spouses are. But of course, I knew that wasn't possible because the federal government did not recognize our marriage, did not see our relationship. It was impossible, I knew that. Until one day, my phone rang. It was Commissioner Avakian. He called. He was asking for a donation for his re-election campaign. I didn't know too much about the labor commissioner, so I asked him about his job and his record and his goals. And when he told me that he was the highest civil rights authority in the state of Oregon, then I said to him, I am so hurt and so frustrated. The other benefits, your health care, all those things, that would be nice. But I said, the thing that really hurts is that I can't be buried in the National Cemetery with Nancy, my partner and wife. I want to be honored. I want our union to be honored and memorialized in stone as my folks' long marriage was. But then I said, I'm sorry, I know you're a state official, and I know this is a federal matter. And I said, I know there's nothing you can do about it. And that's when he said words that changed my life forever. He said, Linda, don't be too sure about that. He said, let me look into it, and I'll call you back. He never did ask for the donation. And true to his word, the next day he called me back. And he said, Linda, if you really want to pursue burial at Willamette National Cemetery, why don't you go ahead and put the application in? But rather than sending it directly to the Secretary of Veterans Affairs in Washington, D.C., why don't you send it to me, and I'll put a cover letter on it? And that's what we did, and that was the beginning of our struggle. And during the 9 months it took to get that approval, Senator Jeff Merkley enthusiastically joined our team. We did gain approval, and now this country of ours does, now and forever, honor the loving relationship between Nancy and me. I suppose at that point, I could have been content with that extraordinary turn of events, but Nancy's voice within me, bolstered by my own belief, was that if this was going to be her final resting place, and if it were going to be mine eventually too, it needed to represent really who we were. Months earlier, when Nancy was sick, we had envisioned approval of our burial, and we started thinking about what our headstone might look like. And the Veterans Administration has about 50 different symbols that a family can choose from to have on the headstone. Most people would choose perhaps the Christian cross or the Star of David. Some people don't have any symbol at all. None of the symbols particularly struck Nancy or me. I asked her what symbol she might like to have on the headstone. She says, oh, maybe a bicycle. I said, I don't think they're going to go for that. I said, how about a tree or a mountain or a bird? And she said, that would be fine. After the approval was given, I was talking with an official back in Washington, D.C., and I thanked her tremendously for all that they had done for us and for the approval. But I said, there's just one more thing. Nancy and I would like to have a symbol that represents us, one that's not on the approved list. And she said, oh, no, no. She said, that's difficult, if not impossible. So I put the application in, and only 4 months later, we gained the approval for the sandhill crane. I chose the sandhill crane for many reasons, and I'll relate some of those to you. The sandhill crane has been revered by many people since the time of the ancient Egyptians. It continues to be revered today in Asia and South America and by many Native American people. And the sandhill crane can comfortably move between water, earth, and sky, and can open doors between all worlds, realms, and times. They symbolize peace for many people around the world, and they tell us that there's hope even in darkness. And when the sandhill crane appears, there's usually some hidden protection around us and an energy of secret guardianship. The crane is inquisitive and in search of spiritual wisdom. For these reasons, I chose the crane to watch over Nancy and to watch over both of us one day. So at last, the symbol was approved and the stone was engraved, and I was able to bring Nancy home for burial near my folks, where they lie together, as Nancy and I someday will. But as much as I miss her, many moments of every day, I'm not anxious to join her because she's inside of me She's alongside of me. She's casting her light all around me. She's inspiring me to be the strong and powerful woman that I am and that I never knew I could be. And since she's left, I've done many things that I never thought I could. And that leads me to the message I'd like to leave with all of you. I invite you to open the envelopes that were passed out to you when you came in. This is a mirror. I ask you to open it and look into that mirror. Look into that mirror. Block out the world. See the person you are. The good and honorable and deserving person that you are. The good and honorable and deserving person that you are. And tell that person, I will stand up for you. I did that, finally. And you can. And if we all did that together, believing in our own dignity and our own worth, standing up and claiming for ourselves what we deserve, imagine how powerful that would feel. Today, when I look in the mirror, I don't particularly say, oh, look at that powerful woman. But I do see reflected back at me the power that comes from telling the truth about my life. Finally, having the world recognize the eternal union that Nancy and I share, it's freeing. It's an absolutely glorious feeling. I wish that feeling for all of us, for every one of you, for every gay and gray one of us, and all of our generations to follow. Thank you.
I think most of us are probably feeling somewhat speechless. Wow. Thank you, Linda Campbell. So, besides the mirror, you got a sticker that says, I got kissed at Gay and Gray Expo. And with your permission, Linda, I'd like to kiss you. People in this room instead of 100. This is a message that rings so true for every one of us who have ever loved anybody, let alone a person of the same gender, and who have had to keep it a secret, and who have struggled and have had heartache, and who have had to change who we are literally in order to survive in this world. You have told a story that we can all relate to, and yet through it all, and through the loss of the absolute love of your life and soulmate of your life, you have come through and you have become an activist. And that is the job of all of us. When we leave this place today, we pronounce you activists for life.